Good morning. We start with breaking news. And the alleged chef of a fatal mushroom lunch, which claimed the lives of three people and captured worldwide attention, has been charged with three counts of murder and five counts of attempted murder. Eliza Rugg is following the story. Eliza, Erin Patterson has fronted court this morning.
She has, Davina. It was only a brief hearing here at the Latrobe Valley Magistrates Court. Erin Patterson sat in the dock. She was calm. She stared blankly ahead. She was flanked by two prison guards as well. The main point to come out of today's hearing is that police have requested a 20-week adjournment, they say, because they need to go through the amount of computer evidence that was seized from Erin Patterson's home yesterday. We know after that search warrant was executed at her home, she was hit with eight charges, three of them the most serious, three murder charges. They relate to the deaths of three people in July after they consumed what's believed to be poisonous mushrooms at a lunch that Erin Patterson allegedly served. One other attempted murder charge relating to the survivor of that lunch, and one other attempted murder charge relating to Simon Patterson, Erin Patterson's estranged husband, who we understand was meant to attend that lunch but ended up pulling out at the last minute. Surprisingly, there were also three other attempted murder charges laid against Erin Patterson. Police will allege that she actually tried to poison her husband, her former husband, three times in 2021 and 2022. Today in court, Ms. Patterson's lawyer said he is still waiting to see the analysis of the evidence in the case against her. How's your client doing in custody?
She's good, thanks. I've just got to get through.
Will she be fighting these charges, Mr. Du?
It's early days and we haven't received a brief.
Now, Erin Patterson couldn't make a bail application today, Davina, because you can only do that in Victoria in the Supreme Court if you've been charged with murder. So she's been remanded in custody. We'll see her in court in May next year.
Eliza, thank you. Australia's most wanted man has been arrested in Istanbul, along with other members of the Comanchero bike group, for allegedly running a global drug trafficking syndicate. Our chief court reporter, Tiffany Genders, has more. Tiff, just tell us how significant this bust is.
Well, Davina, this was the gotcha moment for the AFP's enemy number one, Hakan Ayik, arrested in Istanbul during dawn raids, ending his more than decade-long run as an international fugitive. The 44-year-old was seemingly caught unaware, he's pictured shirtless, on his knees and with his hands cuffed behind his back. Now, the Turkish Minister of International Affairs broke the news of this major scalp in a video that almost looked like a Hollywood production. Ayik, one of 37 people captured, others including members of Australia's Comanchero bikie gang. They're all wanted over their alleged involvement in a global drug ring and for laundering money made from that trade. $250 million Australian dollars so far collected during this mammoth operation.
So why is he Australia's most wanted man?
Well, Ayik was wanted for drug offences when he fled the country back in 2010, and since then he's been suspected of being one of the main players in this international syndicate, allegedly sourcing drugs from South America and then sending them to Australia with the help of bikie gangs. Now, Ayik's alleged right-hand man, Mark Buttle, was arrested in Turkey last year, then deported and delivered into the hands of Australian Federal Police. Right now he's in custody in Victoria, accused of importing millions of dollars worth of cocaine into the country. But unlike Buttle, Hakan Ayik won't be extradited or deported from Turkey because he is a dual national with Turkish citizenship. Davina, will hear from the AFP regarding the arrest of Australia's most wanted man a little bit later this afternoon.
It is a huge story, Tiff. Okay, thank you. Well, more Australians are hoping to flee Gaza today as the conflict in the Middle East stretches into its fourth week. Meanwhile, Israeli forces are extending their bombing campaign on the Palestinian enclave. Our Europe correspondent Karianne Greenbank has the details.
We're here at the largest ground forces training facility in Israel, and it's here that regular soldiers and reservists have been training ahead of being sent into Gaza. The Israeli military saying its tanks and troops are now on the outskirts of Gaza City, but facing fierce resistance. Those 20 Australians who crossed from Gaza to Egypt yesterday will be returning to Australia very soon. And DFAT says it's working around the clock to help the 65 other Australian citizens, permanent residents and visa holders who are still trapped in Gaza. We spoke with one couple, Abdallah and Samar, who had to return home after being told Abdallah could leave Gaza, but his wife couldn't. They've spent today surrounded by buildings being hit by airstrikes, they tell me. The closest, they say, was around 200 metres away. They're still waiting to find out whether Samar will be approved to leave Gaza, and they're getting more worried by the day. Israel appears to be pushing forward with its plans to cut off the north from the south and encircle Gaza City.
Two men have been issued with infringement notices for alleged offence behaviour after they removed posters of kidnapped Israelis that had been hung at Sydney's Bondi Beach. There were tense scenes as the 25-year-old and 40-year-old men were caught ripping down the signs. The memorial, which has since been restored, was set up by Israeli supporters for the 230 hostages taken by Hamas. The infringement notices carry a fine of $500. The Prime Minister is preparing to head to China tomorrow, breaking a 7-year impasse in leaders' visits, with trade set to be top of the agenda. We'll go live to Canberra and our politics reporter, Eliza Edwards. Eliza, what should we expect from this sort of visit?
Well, Davina, this is a big moment. It's the first time since 2016 an Australian Prime Minister has visited China, and it's been a tumultuous 7 years in the relationship since then, marred by trade tensions and growing concern about Beijing's influence in the Pacific. Anthony Albanese will fly out tomorrow morning. He'll firstly visit a trade event in Shanghai, where he'll be advocating for the dropping of those remaining sanctions on things like Australian lobster and red meat. It's also expected the PM will push back on China's bid to join a trans-Pacific free trading bloc. China wants in, but other countries want to keep China out because of its past record of economic coercion. Here's what the opposition had to say about the Prime Minister's upcoming visit.
China is one of our great trading partners. Their support of our export is incredibly important for our economy here at home, but it shouldn't come at the risk of our own sovereignty.
Davina, while the Deputy Prime Minister has been in the UK attending an artificial intelligence summit where overnight Australia joined 27 other nations, including China, in signing a new declaration. This is about vowing to collaborate on testing the next generation of AI to protect countries against national security and safety risks, including ensuring there are rules around how AI could be used when engaging in warfare.
It's critically important that artificial intelligence is not deployed in a defence context which undermines the obligations that we have under a range of international treaties.
There'll be several more global summits held over the next year, Davina, to monitor the advancement of this fast-moving tech frontier.
OK, Eliza, thank you. A woman is in hospital after being mowed down by a car in Sydney's west this morning. Hayley Francis reports.
Well, paramedics were called here to Sheringham Road at Cranbrook just before four this morning after a woman was found lying in the gutter, suffering serious injuries as well as an amputated finger. Police believe the 27-year-old had been hit by a car, the driver then taking off.
I just actually heard, I don't know who it was, but just an argument like in the street. I came out, had a look, but I didn't see anything at the time.
Detectives are now looking into what exactly happened prior to this hit and run. Residents say they heard two people arguing on nearby McGann Place in the early hours of the morning. It's believed a person was also found in a home there suffering multiple lacerations. Now, the 27-year-old remains in hospital as detectives now work their way through two crime scenes here at Cranbrook. It's hoped more answers will come to hand in the following hours.
A 10-year-old boy has been reunited with his family in Melbourne's west after a search spanned more than 10 hours overnight. The police air wing and SES crews were on call to help look for the boy who has nonverbal autism. It was just before 8 a.m. when a neighbour opened his van and found him sitting inside.